once upon a time, before the creation of America, was just a figment of the founding fathers of the Constitution's imagination. North and South America were proud, thriving nations whom ruled by their own accord. They ruled not by their own laws, but by their gut instincts. It wasn't perfect, but it was a way of life, for they respected the laws of the land. Then, as time progressed and European expansion moved on into the New World, their way of life was systematically turned upside down. Indian lands were uprooted from themselves due to American colonization. Wars were fought, many unfortunate Indians perished, especially along the Trail of Tears. This boxed Native Americans in what was known as reservations. It only gets worse in time, as pop culture would rear its ugly head, depicting Native Americans with tobacco, broken fictional English known as Tonto speak, and mocking the traditions and customs of other Native Americans by the release of the children's book, Let's Play Indian, by Chastain. Let's Play Indian, come on, like, come on. Sports team franchises would cash in on their namesakes that some today refuse to change. Westerners have always depicted Native Americans in movies as brute savages whom only wish is to rid the white man of our lands. This is all child's play compared to the modern day version of Let's Mock Indians with this installment of Running Zack. The show opens where an elated bunch practically have a circle jerk around Zack, praising him for his first place showing at the last track meet.
Zack, you were so awesome at the track meet.
Oh. So far this year, Zack has proven to be their ace star runner and their only hope to beat Valley this Friday.
Kelly, come on, you're making me blush.
Zack still wants to celebrate his moment of sweetness with the only five people enrolled at Bayside.
I haven't seen you run that fast since the time you stole Cindy Zeffirelli's bathing suit.
And Zack's celebration is cut short and short-lived, for Lisa must return home to complete her history project.
What'd you find out?
Well, my great-great-great-grandfather was a slave in the Old South.
Oh no, that's terrible.
Good Lord, NBC. You waited until the second season to acknowledge her race.
You must have been a very brave man.
Even though she was supposed to be a Jewish character, but that's different. Enough with the color blindness bullcrap. Oh wait, right. Early 90s, Rodney King, LA riots, OJ Simpson. Yeah, now that I think about it, the further the show got into a sensitive topic of concern was lecturing about the evils of caffeine pills. Let me guess, with Slater being Latino, with his grandfather, the El Matador, I can't do that, Tito Santana, Jessie gives no clue into her ancestors, but only whimpers, think of the animals.
My ancestors? Well, they're dead.
Wow, that's heavy stuff, Jessie.
Yep, all of them. They died hundreds of years ago.
Of course, our beloved procrastinator Zack has yet to do his assignment, and so all he knows, as stated in the Bible, just like Adam and Eve, that he is related to stock photo of Indian chief, because it makes for good BS material to smuggle him in an A for as little effort as possible.
Looks like my Aunt Hannah. Except she had thicker sideburns.
He wasn't going for an A, he was going for like a probably C. So this goes back to my intro and how it relates to this fucked up genealogy we're about to dissect into the Morris family tree.
You don't remember my mom telling me stories about a distant Indian relative?
Oh, my mom tells me stories about four-eyed monsters hiding in my closet.
Morris is another common last name that has English, Scottish, Welsh, Irish, German, and Jewish roots. Also, take into account Zack's physical features, his blonde hair, fair skin, and freckles. Yeah, not quite Indian-like.
See a doctor, Zack. They're not there.
Wasn't he half Filipino or something? Maybe it's on his mother's side, or he gets it from his dad. No, the dude is of Nordic descent, and that is final.
How? That's a good start.
But he's not an Indian.
How? That's a good start.
In the next day's class is the start of the history project presentation as Lisa finishes her brief but best Rand McNally presentation created in a GPS minute that I have ever seen.
Cloak of Darkness, he helped sneak other slaves, or passengers as they were secretly called, to freedom along this route from Atlanta to New York.
Miss Wentworth yet returns again, and by this time, she probably had her sex therapist's license revoked, but then again, don't we all need work these days?
Yes.
It's Jessie's turn, and for some reason, she can't bear to go on anymore with the cold hard truth that her ancestors were slave traders?
Ancestors were seafaring people. They sailed around the world on ships. They were shippers, okay? Thank you, I'm finished.
That's a whole nother thing.
Jessie, perhaps you could tell us a bit more.
I could see her ancestors as mafia crime lords in Sicily, but slave traders?
Well, they ship tea, spices, people, lumber, that kind of thing.
People?
Thanks, NBC. Another job I got to get my hands dirty. So let's break down the last name, Spano.
Well, Jessie, you had nothing to do with it.
Well, it takes no genealogist to debunk that Spano is an Italian surname. Knock, knock, NBC. And guess what? This may come as a surprise to you, but the Italians were never in any way, shape, or form involved in the American slave trade.
Oh, just say it, you hate me. Unleash those centuries of repressed anger.
So what we have here is a half-assed exploration of woe is me, putting on the white guilt on the most overly socially conscious sitcom around.
Jessie, you're being silly.
Now Jessie's paranoia reaches a fever pitch with everyone disliking her in regards to her ancestors, even Lisa.
More, I can take it.
Thank you, Jessie, you can sit down now.
Lisa can't believe she is the only one trying to keep a straight face.
Oh, see, now you hate me too. I can see it in your voice.
Well, Miss Wentworth tries to tell Jessie to take a Valium, sit down, and get a grip. And now we give you the most racially insensitive portrayal since Samba Simba in this feature titled Dress Up Like a Racial Stereotype. Yes, apparently Screech feels all Native Americans are paralyzed on one side of their bodies and enjoy holding their arms crossed, grunting like apes, and oh God, Jesus, no.
Search of their daily food.
They hungry.
Wearing fake lipstick war paint. Can this get any more stomach gut wrenching?
Whoa, Tonto.
Dare I say, what the hell is that?
Me got a question. What's the name of your tribe?
What was he planning to do? Grunt like a caveman while chanting the Atlanta Braves and Florida State Seminoles war chant song?
This weird, outdated view of what it means to be Native.
We only brought those out in defense of ourselves, our land, our people.
Like you see the Atlantic Games and they're doing the ooh.
perpetuates one very specific and very outdated image.
Yes, I understand you're trying to set up Zack to learn a valuable lesson. Hopefully, it's in race relations. Alright, writers. You systematically destroyed Zack and Screech's reputation as worthless, shit-faced asshole racist who can't tell the difference between a Native American and the Flintstones.
The Cherokee.
And where were they located?
They lived in the valley. Oh, but way far out.
Is that a reservation or a roadside hotel you are referring to?
Past the freeway.
I would like to remind our viewers that the Cherokee tribe Zack is referring to was also the tribe involved in the Trail of Tears massacre.
What you did was disrespectful to the class and to your ancestors.
After class, Miss Wentworth notified Zack that his presentation was about as revolting as Chief Wahoo, the Smoking Indian, and advised him to go see a friend of hers after school.
But I have practice after school, and the track championship is on Friday.
Go hang out with this adult kid. That's cool. I'm guessing Miss Wentworth is going for the shortest tenure of faculty staff to go against school regulations to require a student to visit an adult without parental approval or supervision.
Don't pass this class, Kimasabi. The only place you'll be running is to summer school.
He arrives at said stranger's house only to meet Chief Henry, Miss Wentworth's friend.
Zack Morris from Miss Wentworth's class.
Oh, the kid who thinks he's part Indian.
Let me take a moment to address Chief Henry. What in the hell is his occupation? This isn't an apartment, it looks like Joe's garage.
What's it up?
Let's wrap.
They say he attended UCLA, but from the looks of it, I'm gonna say Quaker State. Or was that Pennzoil?
No, UCLA. Great arts and crafts department there.
What exactly is he a chief of? It's a name of high-ranking honor amongst many Indian tribes that no one can just assume the role of.
You're supposed to be an Indian. Why are you wearing a Dodger hat?
Well, because a Raider helmet's too hot.
Not everyone can be chief riders. Some are casino owners, some are even their own reservation chief of police, but not of a tribe.
Hang ten, dude.
If you NBC writers want to be crowned chief asshole for this one, well then you've definitely earned your crown. Yet most important, public safety question, what is Wentworth's relationship to Chief Henry? Old college roomies? Part of an Indian rights protesting group? Which is my best guess.
Technically, but only if you count weekends.
Fuck buddies. Nah.
I don't.
Picture that one.
Aw, gee, Miss Wentworth.
I have already gone blind to the lack of cultural sensitivity that I do not wish to have another unsettling visual at the moment. I mean, if Chief Henry confirms Zack Morris's Indian heritage as bullshit, then it must be.
You see, it's a technicality.
Even the writers are having a conundrum as to how bullshit this plot is.
The better win for Zack is a solid education.
Zack later shows Chief Henry the royalty-free Indian stock photo, but could care less about what the chief has to say, because when you were in high school, being on top is everything.
I have to finish this project so I can train for a track meet.
I thought you wanted to know all about this man.
Well, not all about him, just enough for a 3-minute speech.
That's not before Chief Henry gives him a free education and mounds upon mounds of books on the history of his tribe to test his loyalty to his roots to see if our young shyster is not bullshitting the chief.
You did say a 3-minute speech, right?
Right.
Call me if you need any more.
Does Zack grin and bear it? No, he comes crying to Mr. Belding, whom for the first of many rare times actually sides with Zack.
I'm sure that Miss Wentworth will be a little more reasonable after I flex some principal muscle.
Winning is everything over GPA. So back at the Max, Zack catches up on some Indian history from the books he was given when Kelly, Jessie, and Lisa walk in and are devastated that Zack will be missing the tournament. If only Kimo Sabe were here, could get to play.
Coach Neely was really mad you didn't show up. He threw the shot put at Belding.
Meanwhile, Jessie is constantly on Lisa's case to make up for years of turmoil and tragedy caused by the African slave trade.
Lisa, let me buy you a soda to make up for my ancestors.
No thanks, I'm not thirsty.
I am.
Who cares? You weren't a slave.
Yeah, Coke and a smile certainly makes up for years of oppression, degradation, and enslaved African-American ancestry.
How about cooling it?
But in typical Lisa fashion, which is why you gotta love her, she finds a way to program Jessie to do her bidding and be her sugar mommy for a day.
I will take you there. I'll carry you on my back.
There's a picture, driving Miss Dizzy.
This makes Slater jealous, because no one has bothered to poke fun at the Latino community.
Mind your own business, bull killer.
Hey, that's bull fighter, slave trader.
Zack Morris later finds the Indian stock photo in one of his books is of another chief and seeks out Chief Henry for more information.
Yeah, says Neri was a famous chef. Not a chef, you idiot, a chief.
Jeez, is everyone a chief in this episode? Chief Wiss. Since Zack Morris is so thirsty to the path and the truth of the brave Chief Henry dons him a stereotypical Indian name, Running Zack.
Running Zack?
What's your new name? You run, you're Zack, it works.
I would have gone with Weasel, because like Bobby Heenan, he can't help weasel his way in and out of things. Through some deep diving, Chief Henry claims Zack's great-great-great-grandfather was part of the Nez Perce tribe, a group that was actually very prevalent in the north-central Idaho area and eventually branched into Washington, Wyoming, and Montana. So if Chief Henry knows so much about Zack's ancestors, do they all keep backlogs of data on each other?
I guess you got enough for your report now.
Zack and Chief agree to catch a breeze at the beach, but not before Chief Henry dons him with some stereotypical Native American headband that symbolizes Zack's tribe.
A symbol of your tribe.
Did you make this?
Last night.
After all the continuing cock and bull, does it hurt to question the validity of this or pass another kidney stone?
I'll tell you how Whispering Wind helped save your people.
The final day of group presentations kick off with Screech, who is also Italian, whom puts on the most foul Italian womanizing pickup lines he can devise, because I'm guessing Power says, hey, oh, that's Italian, that's amore.
The great-grandson of Luigi Powerelli. The dashing and debonair Italian lover and spy.
That's the thing, right? I don't know.
In the worldwide found him irresistible.
Fuck it. Honestly, he comes off as one of the Mario brothers. Luigi Mario. Yes, of course. Sexually harassing Lisa, yet still manages to get an A.
Buongiorno, baby.
Arrivederci, dorky.
Oh, the 1990s.
Screech, obviously you are a pepperoni off the old block.
Thank God he didn't spring to offer pizza, spaghetti, and matzo balls.
Hey!
And last, but offensively to say the least, Running Zack in full Indian garb.
My name is Running Zack.
Now that I think of it, I like the exaggerated stereotypes better than shamelessly slam someone.
I am a direct descendant of the Nez Perce tribe who once lived peacefully in Oregon's Wallowa Valley.
Even the audiences didn't know whether to laugh or stage a walkout.
Forced off their land so settlers could mine for gold.
Here, Zack gives a head-on crash course about the history of his tribe and throws every Native American cliche in the book, including alcoholism.
After fighting to keep their home, the tribe, led by Great Chief Joseph, tried retreating to safety in the mountains.
Alcohol. Well, why wait? I'll have what you are too young to be having. Everyone is elated at his project, including Mr. Belding.
Zack, I love you!
A little uncontrollably happy.
I mean, I like you. I mean, job well done, son. Keep up the good work.
Zack Morse wishes to phone Chief Henry to tell him of the good news, but the sour look on his face can only mean something bad went down.
What?
Meanwhile, Make Me Feel Like Shit Week resumes as Jessie continues to kiss Lisa's ass.
Lisa, the guilt won't go away. At least let me repave your parents' driveway. I can do it in a weekend.
Equality rules!
Jessie, stop already!
The pep rally takes place at Bayside's money laundering front, The Max, where Lisa shows off her acrylic nails for a good sense of catfighting will help claw her way to the finish line.
We're gonna win tomorrow, and if my race is close, I have a little trick I borrowed from Flojo to reach the tape quicker.
Kelly puts on some of the worst cheers yet, and that says a lot from the show's favorite neutral sweetheart.
Lisa is the quickest girl on 2 feet. With her on her side, we can't be beat. Go, Lisa!
Sorry, Cupcake, you can't win them all. Yet, through all this hype, they don't even notice that Zack, their star runner, is not present.
Wow, Zack's so fast I didn't even see him come in.
Wow, he's magically made himself irrelevant.
It's because he didn't show up, you twink.
Oh wait, remorseful. A rare act of Zack. Kelly goes out looking for Zack, and she finds him and Mrs. Wentworth mourning the loss of Chief Henry.
Kelly, he's gone.
Someone of great importance, yet never seen at all until this episode.
A friend of ours passed away.
Funny, he seemed perfectly fine, robust, and tip-top shape.
Chief Henry died this morning.
Zack, I'm so sorry.
Must have died from the common deadly plot, contrivance-itis, in which our favorite peacock writers at NBC try to manipulate us into feeling like crap over something we never had an emotional tie to begin with.
Is there anything I can do for you?
Zack is just so broken up about it that he can't run because the plot has him tripping in his sleep that he thinks he's dreaming. That's not until Chief Henry waltz right on in and makes himself right at home alongside Zack.
Chief Henry, you're alive?
No, I'm still dead.
You should always maintain social distancing from spirits, Zack.
You know what? Life is a lot less stressful when you're dead.
You could contract a bad case of possession.
Why'd you have to die?
They don't give you much choice up there.
Chief Henry assures him that all of his episode's answers lie in the palm of his hand.
Are you ready for the big meet tomorrow? I hear Valley's shaking in their Nikes. The answer to your problem is in your hands.
Now he can be the most racist runner. We return to Bayside, and Jessie is still playing the ancestral blame game, and Lisa has had her fill.
You don't leave me alone, I'm gonna kick your butt.
She wanted them to come to an agreement that whatever their ancestors did to each other shouldn't result in a free fist for all beating the living crap out of each other. All hopes to beat Valley are in the neighborhood of make-believe until Zack Morris comes walking down the stairs.
Boy, do we need you. All right, everybody, let's go beat Valley. Like,
yeah,
for sure.
The answer inscribed on the back of his headband is printed, beat Valley.
Beat Valley.
This one's for you.
Either that or is some whacked out supernatural shit going on. Either way, it helps Running Zack channel the everywhere spirit to leave Valley in the dust. Now that insensitive, contrived nightmare of an episode is over, I wholeheartedly apologize to the failures of our ignorant writers who successfully managed to screw up two racially sensitive plots. These writers are about as deep as a Twilight Zone going straight for sensationalism rather than going for pure emotion on a sensitive subject. If there is any Native American watching, we apologize for their stupidity, as this marks the first and last time on this program that they do you wrong no more.
This one's for you.